Please unmute yourself.
Okay. Can I share my screen?
Yes.
Did Prakash join? Dr. Prakash?
Yes, madam, I'm online. Yes,
madam. Oh, yeah. Okay, Mofajjal, please start.
Okay, madam. Respected Independence Awardee, Mother of Pediatric Cardiology and Pioneer in International Pediatric Cardiology, Bangladesh, and Legendary Professor of Pediatric Cardiology, Brigadier General Noor Nar Fatima, CMS Dhaka, Chief Pediatric Cardiologist, Lab 8 Dhaka, and Chairman of Congenital Heart Disease Foundation, Bangladesh. Respected Senior Consultant Pediatric Cardiology, Square Hospital, Bangladesh, Professor ABS Abdus Salam. Respected distinguished participants in home and abroad, Assalamu alaikum and good afternoon to you all. I myself, Lieutenant Colonel Mufajjal, welcome you all in this Friday virtual class session organized by Congenital Heart Disease Foundation in collaboration with Congenital Beximco and Congenital Heart Disease Foundation and Beximco Pharma Limited. It is a expanded pleasure and opportunity for me to be a moderator of this session. And heartful thanks to Brigadier General Noor Nar Fatima, Madam. As a continuation of series of classes, this is the day 15. Today's topics of the discussions will be presented by Dr. Prakash Raj from India. And in the month of monsoon, Dr. Pok, before you going to the session, I would like to introduce Dr. Prakash Raj. He's a consultant in pediatric cardiology and Narayana Institute of Cardiac Science and Narayana Health City. And our today's topic is cath lab basic pre-cath investigations, assessment, selection guideline, different role of personnel, PCR guideline, calculation in cath lab sterilization, reuse of disposal and special views. Dr. Prakash Raj, MD Pediatrics and FND in Pediatric Cardiology, Consultant Cardiology and Pediatrics of Narayana Institute of Cardiac Science, Bangalore. His field of experience, echocardiography in pediatrics and adult congenital heart disease, fetal echocardiography, interventional pediatric and adult congenital heart disease, and congenital heart disease hybrid intervention. And key procedure he is used to perform RVOT stenting and ductal stent. He holds various positions in different institutes. Work as a clinical assistant in pediatric cardiac ICU, Narayana Hridayalaya, senior registrar of pediatrics, Fortis Hospital, BG, Bangalore, fellow of pediatric cardiology, Narayana Institute of Cardiac Science, and now working as a senior registrar, pediatric cardiology, Narayana Institute of Cardiac Science. He published various articles in the international journals and also in very fluent in various languages. Now, I like to invite Dr. Prakash Raj for this today's topics of the day. It is very basic for the cardiology students, that related to cath lab basics and pre-cath investigations and associated calculation and selection of cath lab sterilization and reuse of disposable and very special view in these topics. Dr. Prakash Raj, I welcome you all to present your case to this.
Namaste. Good evening, everybody. Hope I am audible before I start.
Yes, you are audible.
Yes. Okay. So I first of all thank Brigadier Noor Nahar Fatima Madam for giving me an opportunity to hold this session. So I would be talking more about clinical aspects of the cath lab basics. So in this 45-minute session, it will be difficult to add the hardware reuse and CCR guidelines. So mainly the clinical part of the cath lab basics I would be discussing today. So overview of my presentation will be what are the indications of pediatric cardiac cath procedures. We would broadly classify it as a diagnostic or interventional procedure. The aims and limitations of the diagnostic cardiac catheterization, the complications associated with it, the case selection and planning, the basic calculations of cardiac output, QPQS, the pulmonary and systemic vascular resistance, and cath views. These are the things I would be covering in today's topic. So first, jumping to the indications, basically we classify any cardiac catheterization as a diagnostic cardiac catheterization or an interventional procedure. So in diagnostic cardiac catheterization, we are primarily aiming at defining the physiology or the hemodynamic of the cardiac anomaly. With addition, we even try to define the anatomy of the congenital heart defect, if in case it is inadequately defined by any of the non-invasive tests. For the anatomy, except probably the coronary anatomy or distal pulmonary arteries, there are other safer non-invasive tests like echocardiogram, CT or MRI, which give a better understanding of the anatomy of this congenital heart disease. But specifically the physiology or the hemodynamics of any anomaly is best defined by diagnostic cardiac catheterization, and it is a gold standard for it. The second broad category would be any interventional procedure like device closures, balloon pulmonary or valvotomies, or plasty, arterioplasties. So before we even think of any procedure of cardiac catheterization, we should understand that any cath may progress for a need to intervention. Hence, a basic plan and basic hardwares should always be in place before we embark on a diagnostic cardiac cath. Like for example, when we do a diagnostic cardiac cath, there is a good chance of the patient having an arrhythmia. So you will have to have a cardioverter or a defibrillator or medications to terminate the arrhythmia, or it can go into complete heart block. So you should always have a pacing lead on the table before we embark on the diagnostic catheterization. In the broad category of defining the physiology or the hemodynamics of the diagnostic cardiac catheterization, assessment of PAH in CHD forms the foremost and major chunk of diagnostic cardiac catheterization, where we assess the QPQS, pulmonary vascular resistance, and if the PVR is high, the reversibility for the either oxygen or inhaled nitric oxide or iloprost, some of the pulmonary vasodilators, which we use to assess reversibility of the PVR. In cases of pulmonary atresia with ventricular septal defect and multiple aortopulmonary collaterals, it is definitely better to delineate the aortopulmonary collaterals on catheterization, because we can clearly delineate the single supply versus dual supply, which will help us in deciding whether it needs to be sacrificed. If it's a dual supply or if it's a single supply, you can always unifocalize and also define the PA anatomy so that we have a central pulmonary arteries to which we can unifocalize. In cases of pulmonary atresia with intact ventricular septum, the coronary anatomy and the RV dependent coronary circulation is definitely more well-defined on cardiac catheterization as compared to any one of the non-invasive imaging. In cases of cardiac transplantation, it is more imperative that we get a pulmonary artery pressure, pulmonary vascular resistance, the filling pressures, and also a biopsy in the pre-transplant evaluation and in post-transplant for development of any vasculopathy and for a biopsy to assess if there is any rejection. Those were the class 1 indications for diagnostic care. Now for class 2A indications, most of the centers still do, like in our center, we always do pre-Fontan CAT for assessing the suitability for progressing into Fontan completion. We assess transpulmonary gradient, ventricular end-diastolic pressures, and pulmonary vascular resistance. In cases of cardiomyopathy, to differentiate sometimes restrictive cardiomyopathy or constrictive cardiomyopathy, constrictive pericarditis, and also for taking a biopsy. In cases of in pediatrics, coronary evaluation would be needed in Kawasaki disease, in post-transplant vasculopathy, and in any of the coronary anomalies. The commonest, especially in our institute, we do a lot of immediate post-op diagnostic catheterization for any unexplained deterioration which cannot be explained by any other non-invasive form of imaging. There are a few special categories like in combined lesions like aortic stenosis and aortic regurgitation, where non-invasive tests generally do not clear some of the doubts, which is the dominant lesion, which is the second lesion, or in cases of multi-level obstruction, say subaortic membrane with supravalvar or valvar with supravalvar aortic stenosis, it becomes difficult to assess the which level of obstruction is dominant and how much is the combined obstruction, so that we can form an indication for intervention. As already discussed, diagnostic cath in immediate post-op in the ICU setting is very important. Sometimes you do echo in the immediate post-op and say there is a residual lesion. Your surgeon stands tight and says, no, we checked the step up in the, once we came off the bypass, it was not significant. So you have to give a objective evidence. So we'll have to quantify a residual shunt lesion in the form of QPQS. You may need diagnostic cath to quantify any residual outflow tract obstructions, especially in tetralogy of Fallot, because they may be left some subvalvar RVOT, because when they are in diastole, sometimes they may not see all the three bundles of the right ventricular outflow tract obstruction. Post-Glenn and Fontan to delineate pulmonary AVMs, because immediate post-op, the patient may not be achieving the target saturations which we would have thought otherwise, or presence of any veno-venous collaterals. And in cases of fenestrated Fontan, where the desaturation is such that he may not be able to be extubated, so we may test the closure of fenestrated Fontan by balloon occlusion. If the pressures are good, then probably we can go ahead and close the fenestration as well. And to define aortopulmonary collaterals, when especially in cases of tetralogy where we don't routinely do the CT scan, there may be unexplained increased LA returns when the patient is on CPB. And in cases of BT shunt where occlusion leading to desaturation may not be very well documented on echocardiogram because of either open chest or edema of the chest, or because the patient is ventilated, the imaging may not be great. And the second broad category would be the interventions. There is a myriad of device closures, balloon valvoplasties, balloon angioplasties, and stenting, and atrial septostomy, and interventions for Fontan fenestration, either closure of the fenestration or when there is a Fontan failure to pop off, you have to open the Fontan circuit into the atrium. Or in the recently started procedures, which is bound to become very common after so many years of intracardiac repair for tetralogy of Fallot, that is the pulmonary valve implantation. So next, we'll have to understand what are our aims to do a cardiac catheterization. As already discussed, either two broad categories are diagnostic and intervention. In the diagnostic category, it is first and foremost to define the physiology or the hemodynamics of the heart lesion. And secondarily, if there are any caveats in the imaging, there are any unanswered questions on the anatomy, we can even delineate the anatomy. But comparatively, physiology will be the gold standard for diagnostic cardiac catheterization. In cases of anatomy, there are better non-invasive tests like cardiac MRI, which can give you beautiful images so that you don't have an iota of doubt for the anatomy delineation. In cases of intervention, our aim is to go in, do the intervention where it is indicated and suitable, and come out without any complications. But however, we should never forget to define and confirm the hemodynamics before any intervention. Like in cases of ASD, it doesn't mean you just go inside, put a device and come out. No, you have to do the right heart cath, do the QPQS, assess the pulmonary artery pressures, and then do the procedure. The limitations of cardiac catheterization are, the first and foremost is it's an invasive procedure and it is laced with risk of complications. And there is need for extensive hardware inventory, not just inventory, but also the knowledge, expertise, and experience to use the hardware which is presented at hand, and also improvise on that when there is a requirement, because you cannot have all catheters, all which are available all over the world, to be in your inventory. So you have to have that expertise to improvise on the hardware which is already at hand. And definitely radiation is one of the major limitations of cardiac cath. It is both to the patient, which for many of the patients, say in cases of intervention, it becomes one time, or for an operator, it is cumulative and lifelong. Difficult to maintain the hemodynamic steady state, and if we cannot maintain the steady state, the results of the procedure or the QPQS calculation will be all over the place. So you should always try to maintain the hemodynamic steady state. And if it's not possible, you should have the expertise to interpret with reference to the change in the steady state. And one of the major limitations of delineating the anatomy in diagnostic cath, it is 2D delineation only. Though we have biplane images, but that still just adds some more information, but you generally don't get complete 3D orientation. So these are the broad limitations of the cardiac catheterization. The advantages are majorly two. One is the intervention, percutaneous intervention. Second is the accurate and gold standard hemodynamic assessment. In the present era, there are combined imaging in the cath lab, which adds the advantages of both the modalities, thus negating the limitation of individual imaging. So you can have a 3D TE fluoro overlay for any device closures, or CT, 3D CT fluoro overlay for procedures like pulmonary valve implantation, where otherwise you may have to use humongous amount of contrast to define the very much dilated RV and RVOT. So next, coming to the complications, basically first would be the anesthesia related, which generally our colleagues of the anesthesia department take care. For us particularly, it will be the vascular injury, where there may be occlusion, loss of pulse or limb altogether, possibility of arrhythmias, including heart block and supraventricular or ventricular tachycardias, which needs to be intervened immediately. So again, you have to have appropriate hardware to and medicines to take care of them. We can trigger a cyanotic spell in cases of any tough physiology babies, or stimulate a pulmonary arterial hypertension crisis in cases of ASD with pulmonary hypertension. There can be chance of cardiac perforation, valve injury while manipulating the catheters or the wires, especially the stiff wires. There may be myocardial infarction or ischemia, especially related to single ventricles, where there is polycythemia or there is inadvertent air embolism. Stroke and diffuse brain injury in cases of, again, single ventricles, where there can be paradoxical embolism, or a single ventricle anyway, there is no need for paradoxical. It can embolize. Bleeding, which may require transfusion, allergic reaction to contrast, renal insufficiency, which may be related to contrast or because of the unstable hemodynamics due to any other complications like bleeding also leading to hypotension, that also adds to the renal insufficiency, pre-renal type of renal failure. And last but not the least, and the most dreaded, being death. All over the world, probably it's presently in less than 0.2% of cases where there is life risk. There are a few procedure-specific complications which we always have to keep in mind and explain the patients about the device embolization, either immediate or late, and valve regurgitation, like aortic regurgitation, especially where you may have to do an emergency surgical intervention. In our institute, we generally use a lesion-specific consent forms where we don't need to write anything. It's already written. We tell the patients to go through it, read. We even show them the images of what embolization or things looks like, and then take a consent. So lesion-specific consent forms should be the, at least in India, we are trying to do it all in a lesion-specific consent forms. So that was for device closures. This is for angioplasties. We have another for diagnostic cath and one more for stenting procedures, which lists most of the commonest and most severe form of complications. So coming to the case selection and planning, two things should be the first things which should be thought of when you are selecting a case for cath. One is indication for diagnostic cath. Anyway, intervention, we already have it. So you should not have any ambiguity there, that if there is a soft indication, you'll have to discuss with the patient party that there are other safer modalities available, but why we are doing this, you'll have to chart out the reasons. And you'll have to have a clinical question which needs to be answered. This is the main aim of cath study. And we should always know what we are doing. But always, as always, cath is not always limited to the answer. Like in ASD, we may be doing a operability study. So that does not mean you just complete PA pressure and come out. Everything should be complete and comprehensive. Sometimes in adult patients, we may miss a AP window. So we think it's ASD with pulmonary hypertension. So doing it more vigorously, like do a LV angiogram to make sure there is no post-tricuspid shunt in the ventricular level, do a aortic injection to make sure there is no great artery level shunting. So the study should always be complete and comprehensive. And before the patient is planned for a cath, complete echocardiography with other non-invasive imaging should be done. And only if the anatomy and physiology are not completely explained, that's when we plan for a diagnostic cath. The clinical status should always be examined and documented, because risk profile always depends on this. A stable walking patient, you do a diagnostic cath, it is safer. But in cases of ventricular dysfunction or anatomies like congenital corrected TGA, where there is higher chances of complete heart block, or ventricular dysfunction where even a little change in the hemodynamic status can cause them to arrest or going to even more severe forms of cardiac failure. So clinical status should always be appropriately assessed. Appropriate expertise to perform the cath study, and also expertise to bail out in cases of complications. So always have the surgeons informed about the complex cases you are taking, so that if there is any issue, there is always a chance for bailout. There should be adequate hardware in stock for any eventualities. For example, if we are doing a coarctation stenting or a coarctoplasty, you should always have a covered stent in stock, just in case if there is any need. If there is any need for covering the any intimal tears or aneurysms. And always have the pre-cath investigations well done before we take for the case. And a written informed consent, as already explained, specific consent form is always useful, so that the questions from the patient end are minimal and it is safe medico-legally as well. So as much as possible, anatomy and physiology should be defined by echo with CT or MRI as and when required. Pre-cath investigations, it is generally a basic investigation, complete blood count to make sure there is no chance of any infection. All the other blood parameters are fine, clotting profile, renal function tests, and serology. These are the basic tests which needs to be done before we take any child for a procedure. I've just listed ECG, echo, and X-ray as a part of the basic workup before we take the patient in. We should always plan the access when we see the child and start planning for the procedure. We should always palpate all the pulses and check the local site, especially in cases of any previous cath. So plan the access, which should be based on location of the heart you want to enter and the anatomy and the hardware available. We should always have a contingency in place if the primary access fails to provide entry into the intended site. So a brief checklist of the patient, which we generally do or have to do a day before the procedure. Patient identification is the first and foremost. Correct patient, correct site, correct diagnosis, and correct procedure. So echo and ECG should be performed and confirm that all the parameters are as the patient was seen before the patient is admitted. Review any CT or MRI images just to make sure that you understand the 3D orientation of the heart and how to go about for the procedure. And review all the relevant blood investigations before planning for the procedure. Again, the second important after identification of the patient is the clinical status. Always examine and make sure the clinical status is same as when you planned the procedure. Sometimes a newborn comes for a evaluation. You have seen that it's aortic stenosis severe, but function was fine. He turns up 3 days later and gets admitted. Then the night before you see is dysfunctional. So clinical status has changed a lot, and this again bears on the prognosis. So always clinical status should be examined a day before and confirm that it is at the steady state. Again, check the access site, take a written informed consent, cross-check that it's done. Always have a blood request at hand so that if there is any untoward incident, we can always ask for blood and bail out for the time being for the surgeon to help. And nil per orally as per the list of the day. IV fluids, this is the most important and most neglected part of this checklist, because in small babies, if you keep it nil per orally for 4 to 6 hours, they are bound to get dehydrated. So all your parameters you want to assess, especially the pressures and EDPs, will vary based on if he's well hydrated or dehydrated. So IV fluids should be as per the weight and clinical status. Like in cases of cardiac failure, you definitely do not want to load the patient with fluid. So fluid restriction would be planned. Discuss the type and discuss the type of anesthesia with the team, and it should be based on case-to-case basis. In cases where there are dysfunction, you want a safer procedure, then definitely having the patient anesthetized and intubated would be safer. And third important thing would be to check medications like anticoagulants or antiplatelets or antiarrhythmics, if they have taken at the appropriate time and when it should be stopped. Like antiarrhythmics generally are stopped depending on the medicine 48 to 72 hours before the procedure. So if in case the patient is still taking antiarrhythmics and we try to do a EPS, we may not get any results. So this should be again checked. Access, it again depends on the aim of the study. The standard access all over the world is femoral artery and femoral vein, just because it's become a part of the, it's almost like a ritual and it's easy to access. And sometimes we may have to change the access as per the case. Like jugular vein for any IVC interrupted procedures, even if it is diagnostic cath, it's easier to go from SVC to RA, RV, and PA, or for PDA device closure or VSD device closure or ASD device closure, you can always access internal jugular vein. Obviously, in cases of BD Glenn shunt, you always need a jugular vein to define the Glenn anatomy and physiology. We in our institute are commonly using internal jugular vein in cases of BPV in neonates and infants, because the entry into RA to RV will be easier from the jugular vein, especially when the ventricular size is small or if the tricuspid regurgitation is severe, it's easier to cross from the internal jugular vein. Subclavian artery, axillary artery, or carotid artery, either percutaneous puncture or surgical cut down. We generally use carotid surgical cut down for PDA stenting. And in cases of balloon aortic valvotomy in a small neonate or preemies, carotid or axillary cut down can be used. Radial artery for coarctation stenting where it is difficult to cross retrogradely. Hepatic vein in cases of IVC interruption for either a ASD closure or VSD closures. I mean the device closure. And last but not the least, with the help of our surgical colleagues, hybrid perventricular interventions are very commonly performed. Perventricular VST device off CPB or perventricular pulmonary valve perforation in cases of pulmonary atresia, intact ventricular septum. We have done both of this, and it's easier to perform the perforation of the pulmonary membrane when the baby is very small and getting the catheter across to the PA and holding it under the pulmonary membrane becomes difficult. So next, coming to the most interesting and confusing part is the calculations, which are done especially in cases of operability CATs. So cardiac output, by definition, it's the quantity of blood which is supplied to the systemic circulation per unit time that we measure per minute. So the standard principle which is used worldwide in cardiac catheterization to assess cardiac output is fixed principle, which states that uptake of a substance by any organ is blood flow to the organ multiplied by the arteriovenous concentration difference between the substance, where here we are taking oxygen as the substance. So converting it to the cardiac output, it would be oxygen consumption by arteriovenous oxygen difference. Finally, it is QS, systemic cardiac output. So oxygen consumption and aorta to mixed venous saturation difference. If there is any absence of any shunt, QP is effectively equal to QS. So there are multiple processes which are available, which were used previously, but are cumbersome to be done in a setting of the cath lab for each procedure. So initially the polarographic or the metabolic rate meter was used. The Douglas bag method was used to assess oxygen consumption. And presently in the present era, respiratory mass spectrometry is used. But comparatively, it is easier to use a Lafarge nomogram because we cannot do the Douglas MAC method, which is very cumbersome, or we cannot get access to respiratory mass spectrometry in the cath lab in most of the R centers. So Lafarge nomogram is well applied and very well documented about the validity of the nomograms. But a few caveats here again is it is not validated in children below 3 years and above 40 years, but still adults, we can use the upper limit of the age for oxygen consumption. But less than 3 years, there are a few formulae which are available, which can be used for in cases of children less than 3 years. But again, it again becomes very cumbersome to use that formula in each case. So simple equation, which is standardized. So if you do it across the spectrum, it becomes, you know, even if there is error across the spectrum of all the cases you do, which finally negates the assumptions. So simple equation, especially in adults, we can use is 125 ml plus or minus 25 ml per minute per meter square. So other methods which are used to assess cardiac output in cath lab is dye dilution and thermodilution method, which I think is not a part of this discussion as of now. So I'll skip it for now. So next, coming to the oxygen content. So this is how, because based on fixed principle, we are using the substance which is carried as the oxygen. So oxygen content is the oxygen attached to the hemoglobin plus dissolved oxygen. So depending on the partial pressure of oxygen, the more the partial pressure, the more dissolved oxygen it will have. So we have to take into account both, which is attached to hemoglobin and dissolved in the plasma. So oxygen carrying capacity, oxygen content is the oxygen carrying capacity into percentage saturation. This is attached to hemoglobin, and 0.003 ml per millimeter mercury of PO2 of dissolved oxygen in the plasma. Please note that I have added a factor multiplied by 10 to convert this, which is ml per deciliter to liter. So finally, it becomes 0.03 ml per liter per millimeter mercury PO2. So the oxygen carrying capacity is in a formula is 1.36 ml of oxygen can be attached to 1 gram of hemoglobin, and the amount of hemoglobin per gram deciliter of blood, and again multiplying by a factor of 10 because we need to convert this deciliter into liter. So again, here converting this to deciliter to liter, and here again deciliter to liter, because we get a cardiac output as X amount liters per minute per meter square. So we need to convert everything to liter per minute. So we are converting, adding a multiplying a factor 10 both places to convert it from deciliter to liter. The oxygen content is finally the attached to hemoglobin and dissolved oxygen. So this comes in the unit of ml per minute per liter. So there are a few errors in the oximetry while sampling. One is dilution in the heparinized syringe. If the amount of heparin is too much, say 0.1 to 0.2 ml, and you're doing in a smaller child, you are trying to save more blood, trying to sample less so that can get diluted and get error-filled saturations. If there is a undue time delay in testing, so ideally, all the samples for one run of right heart should be, oximetry run should be around between 2 to 5 minutes. If it is there is a significant delay in testing or sampling, there may be error. There may be inadvertent air bubble in the sample syringe, which will increase the PO2s of the sample. There may be inappropriate mixed venous sample or samples taken at a significant time delay, which again needs, we'll have to understand that we need rapid sampling within 2 to 5 minutes. So easier way is to enter a chamber which is difficult to enter, say in cases of AV canal, because of the VST, inlet VST and primum AST, it becomes very difficult for the catheter to, for us to maneuver into the PA. So it's always put a catheter into asynagata through artery, and from IVC into PA, then start the sampling. So you can take a PA aorta first, then pull back, go to SVC, IVC, RN, take the sample. So in that case, time delay will be avoided. The IVC sampling at a very low level, like below the hepatic veins, near the renal vein, where the renal vein saturations will be very high. SVC sampling at a very low level, or into the RA, where in cases of ASD or VSD with tricuspid regurgitation, there may be error in sampling. And one of the most difficult to attain and continue is a steady state in the hemodynamics. So these are the standard formulae which every one of us are aware of. So QP would be oxygen consumption by content or saturation difference between pulmonary vein to pulmonary artery. QS would be oxygen consumption by saturation or oxygen content difference between aorta and mixed venous. Pulmonary vascular resistance is the transsystemic, that is mean aortic pressure minus pulmonary vascular resistance is mean PA pressure minus pulmonary vein mean over the flow, that is QP. Same is with the systemic vascular resistance. But there is one more term we'll have to regularly use is the QEP, effective pulmonary blood flow. QP is the amount of blood which finally enters the pulmonary circulation. QEP, effective, that is the amount of blood from the systemic veins which is destined to, which should enter the pulmonary veins. So QEP will be equal to QP in case of absence of any left to right shunt. In cases of left to right shunt, we can always negate the QP minus QEP. QEP will give you the left to right shunt. To avoid all the fallacies of assumed VO2s, we can directly go into evaluating the QP-QS ratio by taking off the common oxygen consumption and saturation difference between aorta to mixed venous over pulmonary vein to pulmonary artery. This takes out the most of the fallacies and assumptions which we do while assessing the oxygen consumption, like say Lafarge formula. So next, coming to the shunt evaluation on oximetry. So mixed venous sample, you'll have to understand that SVC most of the times approximates venous saturations. IVC, renal vein, has high saturations, and in cases of coronary sinus, because of high cardiac extraction, the saturations will be low. Many of the fallacies which we generally don't get into idea is, in cases of a very deeply sedated child, the brain is completely deeply sedated, there will be high SVC saturations. In cases of postprandial status, the sats in the hepatic veins will be low. And during exercise, the IVC saturations will be lower as peripheral extractions will be higher. For mixed venous saturation, we generally use the Flam equation, which gives more weightage to the SVC, that is 3 times SVC saturation plus IVC saturation divided by 4. It averages 3 times SVC and 1 time IVC to get the mixed venous saturation. In case many of the places we take the sample, do the procedure and then assess, sometimes the IVC saturation will come up, which may not be representative. Then again, you'll have to understand that we can still take SVC as mixed venous saturation to be representative. So where do we sample? So in cases of mixed veins, we already discussed taking SVC sample as the mixed venous versus Flam formula already. The SVC sampling should be done at the level where the both innominate veins join to form the SVC, and make sure that on echocardiography, there is no PAPVC. Like many of the ASDs will have left upper pulmonary vein going and joining the innominate, that if we have not diagnosed, it can lead to a false high SVC saturation. So in case we already know that it's coming to the left innominate vein, we can go into the right innominate vein or subclavian vein to take the SVC sample. In cases of IVC, we have to take sample at IVC RA junction, just beyond the place where the hepatic vein joins. So it's between hepatic vein and where the IVC joins the RA. In right atrium, it's the mid RA on the lateral wall. In pulmonary arteries, we have to take beyond the hilar vessels, as mixing is incomplete, especially in cases of arterial level shunt, that is PDA or AP window. The mixing will not be complete by the time it reaches the hilar PA. So we'll have to try to take the sample beyond the hilar vessels, but we have to be very mindful of the fact that we have to avoid wet sampling. Otherwise, the saturations will be very high and not representative. Again, the results will be all over the place, which we may not be able to judge after that. So we have to make sure to take the PA sample beyond hilar vessels, but not wetting it. it's always advisable to take both pulmonary arteries and average them. In cases of pulmonary veins, direct sampling, or if there the atrial septum is intact, biseptal puncture as and when it is required. If there is no physiological shunt in the lungs, then we can take aortic sample as indicative of pulmonary vein. Say the lungs are fine, x-ray is fine, there is no pulmonary venous congestion or pulmonary plethora or pulmonary edema, no collapse of the lungs. In such cases, when the lungs are fine, he is well diurised, then probably you can take an aortic sample as indicative of pulmonary vein. And we have to choose a pulmonary, in case where there are x-ray findings of some collapse consolidation in some of the lobes, we have to plan and choose a pulmonary vein of a lung segment which is normal. Coming to the aortic sample, any artery beyond the aorta can be used to take aortic sample, except in cases of ductus where there is right to left or bidirectional shunting, where ascending and descending aortic sample to be taken separately. And as already discussed, the sampling time should be short between aorta and pulmonary vein to avoid missing the physiological shunt at the lung. That means sometimes we are working on taking sample, we may take the aortic sample first and then cross over from septum and take a pulmonary vein. In between, if there is lots of time delay and the depth of anesthesia goes more deep, there may be some hypoventilation. So pulmonary vein sample may come lesser than the aortic sample. So you'll have to, the sampling time between those two should be minimal. A few lesion specific fallacies. SVC sample in cases of PAPVC, as we already discussed, should be above the site of drainage. So we can take from the right innominate. IVC sample in cases of scimitar, so you'll have to define where the drainage is and take the sample below it. Pulmonary artery sample in PDA, you can take from both right and left pulmonary arteries beyond hilar vessels and average both. Aortic sample in cases of PDA, as already discussed, if there is bidirectional shunting, always better to take ascending and descending separately. Pulmonary vein sample in cases of pulmonary AV malformation and collapse, you should always make sure you hit the healthy segments for pulmonary vein sample. Dissolved oxygen, we'll have to understand that in room air ventilation is very minimal and can generally be neglected. So say, for example, FiO2 room air is 21%. The PA, partial pressure of atmospheric oxygen, is generally 160 millimeter of mercury. But once we breathe, there is mixing of with the with the carbon dioxide and water vapor in the respiratory tract. So the PaO2 reduces to 100 or 110. So even with the best of lungs, it can only transmit 100 millimeter of mercury, giving a 100% saturation. So when you calculate dissolved oxygen at room air, it will, as indicated in the formula, it will be 0.03 ml per mmHg per liter, it will come to 3. Just consider a case where we have calculated aortic saturation 99, PaO 200, hemoglobin 12. The dissolved oxygen is only 3. But once we start giving supplemental oxygen, depending on the pressure, especially if it's ventilated, it can still reach up to 300, 400 also. So you can see that when the PaO2 increases from 100 to 300, the dissolved oxygen almost increased proportionately. So in cases of dissolved oxygen, if you are giving supplemental oxygen, post-oxygen study, always make sure you add the dissolved oxygen. One note of caution here is, in cases of high cardiac output, even a lower step up gives an indication to higher QPQS. So higher cardiac output generally leads to lower extraction, so mixed venous saturations will be higher. Take for example, where the patient is fine, the aortic and pulmonary vein saturations are equal in both settings. In a normal cardiac output, generally between 20 to 25% extraction will happen. So we have taken a mixed venous saturation of 70, and there is a step up of 7% from mixed venous to PA. Consider the second example where there is high cardiac output, so lesser extraction, so mixed venous saturations will be higher. Again, consider 7% step up. When we put this into QPQS, where aortic and PV saturations are same, compare the normal cardiac output and high cardiac output. In cases of normal cardiac output, the QPQS came to 1.26, even though the step up is only 7% in both. And in cases of high cardiac output, the same 7% gave a QPQS of 1.5. This is because the new, denominator, the PV minus PA, reduces more as compared to the aorta to mixed venous saturation. So if the mixed venous saturations are higher and you know it's already a high cardiac output, then chances of getting a higher QPQS is noted. So what is the step up of saturation? How much is significant and what does it all mean? So this is the standard, this is mainly for the single sample. So we call it 755. That is 7% step up at atrial level, or 5% at ventricular level, or 5% at great artery level. Or combined, anything more than or equal to 7% is considered significant. In cases of multi-sampling, which probably in the present era we don't do, it would be 533. So three or four runs of QPQS oximetry run is done, and you average and you get 5% at atrial level, 3% at ventricular, 3% at great artery, or more than equal to 5% at any level, overall from SVC to PA, it's considered significant. But for practical issues, for single sampling, which we regularly do, it's 755. So the differential diagnosis at atrial, ventricular, and great artery level are very well known. So I will not go into details of that. So main thing is to understand, to keep this in mind, single sample, 7 atrial, 5 ventricular, 5 great artery, or overall 7. If it's multi-sample, it's 5, 3, 3, and 5. Instead of, as already spoken, if we separately do the QP and QS calculation using the VAO2, there may be added the fallacies of assumptions and other issues with oxygen will add. So direct QP QS calculation negates the fallacies of the VO2 assumption. So already spoken about the formula, that is aorta minus mixed venous by pulmonary vein minus pulmonary artery. That will give you directly QPQS. Similarly, PVR SVR ratio also negates the fallacies of assumption and errors. But still the absolute PVRI is needed in publication and to define the prognosis and operability. So it is still considered important. So by definition, anything more than 3 wood unit PVRI is considered PAH. 3 to 5 wood unit would be borderline, but if it is vasoreactive, then again you can advise closure of the shunts. In cases of shunt PVRI more than 5, it needs vasoreactivity testing, and if it reduces below 5 on reactivity testing, it is noted as reactive or operable, and with due discussion, the patient can be operated for closure of shunts. In case it's more than more than 8 wood unit meter square, then it is considered inoperable, and generally in such high cases, the PVRI even after reactivity testing seldom comes down below 5 wood units. In cases of primary pulmonary hypertension, the absolute PVRI may be suprasystemic, where more than 15, where it's a predictor of high mortality. So operability by diagnostic cardiac catheterization should always be done with a backdrop of the clinical data. CATH report or PVRI, SVRI, QPQS by itself will not decide operability. it adds to already known clinical data. So you should always have a clinical data before we embark on the operability care, like features of CCF, failure to thrive, and recurrent respiratory tract infection, which indicates increased left to right shunt. The age with the lesion, probably ASD, large ASD may not become Eisenmenger till fourth decade, but compare that to a large VST where it can become Eisenmenger by around second or third decade. Compare that to a large PDA or AP window where it can become Eisenmenger within the first decade. Signs of hyperkinetic circulation like precordial activity, fast breathing, flow murmur in the pulmonary area should be noted. Chest X-ray where cardiomegaly and pulmonary plethora help us in indicating that it's operable. ECG where in the post-tricuspid shunt is a LV dominant ECG with Q waves in left lateral leads. Echocardiographically, volume, there is volume overload and left right in shunt pattern, and saturations should be taken at rest and post exercise. This is one of the most important thing which helps us to understand and know if there is any right to left shunting. So this is the standard guidelines criteria we use for assessing and deciding whether it is operable or not. So 20% fall in PVRI, 25% fall in PVRI-SVRI ratio, absolute PVRI less than 6. But in the recent European guidelines, they have made it between 3 to 5 and less than 5 as operable absolute PVRI. PVRI-SVRI ratio of less than 0.3 and PA diastolic pressure mean and PA diastolic pressure versus aortic diastolic pressure less than 0.4. So for CATs which are not done for operability, that is, we have to define the anatomy, like in cases of additional VSTs, AP collaterals, coronary anomalies, PA pressure, where direct entry or pulmonary venous wedge pressure can be taken, especially in cases of single ventricle, and LV routability to aorta, where MRI is not available, we can use this to show any routability. And in cases of pre-Fontan, where PA pressure, CDPs, all your CHOSAT criteria can be assessed. So coming to my last part is the CAT views. So you should always get orthogonal views to define any single structure. So only one injection or one view will never give you a complete evaluation. So you should always use an orthogonal view. If there is a biplane, which is very helpful and it will reduce the amount of contrast. I think I'll show a few images rather than going for reading through all this. So, okay. Single ventricle palliation, generally AP view, generally gives a good anatomic information. Additional views can be used for AP collaterals or venovenous collaterals. For pulmonary valve or the RVOT, lateral view or the shallow RO view will be very useful. For PA anatomy in cases of NRGA, LAO 20, cranial 30 is very good to assess. For main pulmonary artery, again, lateral view can be helpful. For the confluence, it is LAO 20, cranial 30. For aortic valve, again, orthogonal views should be used, which would be LAO 60 and RO 30. Coronary camillary fistula, you always need to individualize because the fistula has multiple turns and runs around all everywhere. So it needs to be individualized. Special mention about congenitally corrected TGA. AP view gives you an anteroposterior orientation of the ventricular septum if the heart is mesocardic. If the heart is still has a levocardia, then shallow LAO view. And if it's dextrocardia, shallow RAO view can be helpful. So just a few examples. So this is standard view LAO long axial oblique where the VST was well defined. But in this case, the VST was not very clear. So we went into a lateral view where this was an outlet defect where it was very well defined. So PDA is standard RAO and lateral. So again, orthogonal views for the same patient. so that you don't miss the critical points. In cases of pulmonary valve RVOT, it is RAO and lateral. So it gives RVOT, pulmonary valve. Main pulmonary artery is not well defined in RAO. As for that, the lateral view defines it well. For the aortic valve in balloon, aortic valvoplasty, again, orthogonal views are used so that crossing becomes easier. So RAO and LAO 60. If you see this single, this thing, just forget this. Just see this single lateral view. You don't seem to completely delineate what is the issue here. But once we take multiple views, you can see that there is a double chambered right ventricle, which could have been easily missed if we had taken only the lateral view. Obviously, we knew beforehand on the echocardiogram, so we took multiple views to define it further. As already indicated, we took a root aortogram for coronary cameral fistula, the huge aneurysmal RCA fistula is running all over the place. Then once we snared and did an AV loop, we could go into the narrowest point and do an injection and define it well. So coronary cameral fistula, there is no hard and fast. Depending on way how the aneurysm is running and how it is draining, you need to change it accordingly. So again, it was a levocardia, though we got a good view on the AP view. So it was levocardia. We went into shallow LAO. We could define the ventricular septum very well. So this is one of the interesting cases which you get to do when you have a large follow-up. This was a case of CCTJ, which underwent double switch operation. So you can see that the IVC is going into the systemic baffle, going into the left-sided ventricle, into the pulmonary artery. And this is the retrograde entry into the left ventricle, right-sided left morphologic left ventricle, giving rise to aorta. So if you see here, you can see the appendage as well. So this is the IVC to venous systemic venous baffle to the right side, morphologic right ventricle on the left side, which gives rise to pulmonary arteries after astole. The pulmonary venous return is to the atrium and through the baffle into the left ventricle, where the left ventricle is draining into the pumping into the aorta. So this is one of the other thing I'll want to discuss. So if you see this single left LV gram and aortogram, you generally don't see anything is amiss. But once we get a AP view, this is of two different patients, but both patients had the same disease. So it was an anatomically corrected malposition. So right atrium draining to morphologic right ventricle, which drains into the pulmonary artery, which is on the right and posterior, where normally related will be on the left and anterior. So subtle features are seen here because if the main pulmonary artery generally goes under the just behind the sternum and goes posteriorly. Here it's more posterior as compared to a normally related. So LV giving rise to L post aorta. So it was a situs solitus situation, and RV was giving rise to, you can see the PA here through that small VST. There is a VST which opacifies the RV and from there to the PA. So this was one of the interesting things you get to do when you are working with a cath lab. So finally, few take home points. Indication should be always be strong and documented. If there is a soft indication, always discuss the alternatives with the parents. Consent should be written, informed. Already spoken about the specific consent forms. Use non-invasive tests to get as much information as possible before embarking on a cath. You should always try to get and maintain a steady state throughout the procedure. So if steady state cannot be maintained, try to do all the single run of the saturation run within that time frame, so that heart rate, the wakefulness of the child is not changed between the time you take SVC sample and PA sample, then it may not be representative of the whole study. Always have the aim of the study, that is what you want to achieve by doing this. So start with the target always, but never end with the only the target. Try to be complete and comprehensive, define complete anatomy and physiology. Take all pressures and blood samples to whichever chamber or vessel you enter and make sure it's recorded in the system so that you can always come back and reassess. And if you have any doubts, you can ask for help from a more experienced or expert person. And always make sure you do the post-processing of the samples immediately and completely. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr.
Mukhajal. Is there any question?
No, madam. There is no question in the box.
No question in the box.
Madam, I have a question to Dr. Prakash.
Yes, please.
Good afternoon, Prakash. This is Ashfaq.
Hi, Ashfaq. How are you doing?
Fine, thank you. Can you tell about something about PCW and the LVDP pressure recording, how to do accurately and how to do the record accurately the pressure tracings? Can you highlight on this?
Yeah. Pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So main thing is you will have to have an endol catheter. So it's easier to get a wedge pressure by having a balloon tipped catheter like Swan-Ganz. So once the balloon is inflated, it goes and wedges on the pulmonary veins. And generally, if the difference, considering that on echocardiography, there is no mitral stenosis or pulmonary vein stenosis, and it is representative of LA pressure and LVEDP. If the difference between LVEDP and pulmonary vein wedge pressure, pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is anything more than 3, it is considered that there is precapillary or arteriolar spasm. Anything more than 7 is definitely a cause of precapillary or pulmonary arteriolar spasm causing hypertension. So it will pulmonary capillary, if you don't have a balloon tip catheter, you can use a multipurpose endol catheter, but you have to make sure that the pressure tracings are on the screen and there is variability when the patient is breathing. In case of overwedging, the pressure trace generally, the trace which was there, it generally dissociates and goes towards the zero. If the wedge pressure is correct, you will have both the A and V waves with respiratory changes. So that is a good wedge pressure. If you have a balloon tip catheter, nothing better than that. As for the ventricular EDPs, it's easier to get into a ventricle and take it. And again, you have to have an understanding that we have to make sure the mitral valve is fine. And as far as possible, try to interrogate and see if there is any pulmonary vein obstruction.
Any more question from anybody? Mufajjal, is there any question? And if not, we can say something and we can conclude, because the lecture was a very long one and Prakash is already tired. So we have to relieve him.
Mohan sir.
Hello, excuse me.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Prakash, for your excellent logical and lucid presentation.
Sure, sir. Thank you.
Doing a professional lecture in a big audience, as if you were telling from the side of the cath room, just as a tutorial. It was so impressive and so explaining, self-explaining. I really enjoyed. You touched everything, I think. Nothing is left for practical purpose.
Yes.
So I really enjoyed. Actually, this is the. I think this will be very helpful for the for our students, for our juniors, as well as for the senior colleagues for recapitulation of the tough things of particularly hemodynamic study, which is essential part of pediatric cardiology practice in our day-to-day life. So I have a simple query. Where you like to do the right to left shunt calculation? What are those situations and how do you do it? Not at the fallacies. Right to left shunt.
Right to left shunting, one can be at the heart level or the second, which we call as anatomical right to left shunt, that is ASD right to left or ASD bidirectional, or at ventricular or great artery level, that is anatomical right to left. Second would be the physiological right to left, that is pulmonary AV malformation or any pulmonary artery to left atrial fistula or any collapse where of the lung where the blood does not enter the capillary. So those two categories we'll have to I cannot recall the formula. So there are formulae we Q QS by minus QEP would be the right to left shunting. Yes. QS minus QEP would be the right to left anatomical shunting.
But in case of severe, say borderline case, having a bidirectional shunt, in case of large BSD, in that case, only PVR as well as QPQS and magnitude of left to left shunt and reversibility is sufficient for assessment, or you have to do the right to left shunt also.
So it will definitely give a better idea as to the quantum of right to left shunt. But if we can get a reversibility criteria to as per the old BARS criteria less than 6 Wood units, or as per the new European guidelines where they say less than 5 would be adequate, that would be the aim of the study. But if we can calculate and get a quantum of right to left shunt, then definitely it will help us understand and prognosticate the case better.
Thank you very much.
Sure.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Salam Bhai. Now, I would like to thank Dr. Prakash for taking a huge pain to prepare this lecture for our student. This was really an outstanding preparation of his lecture, and this will be recorded, and this lecture will be in record for our student for future reference. So I just want to mention here that cardiac catheterization is maybe simple for some person who are very skillful, maybe simple for some simple diseases, but cardiac catheterization may turn into a very nightmare procedure, and any type of complication may happen in any simple procedure. Even for a simple like tetralogy fellow, you are doing a tetralogy fellow case for seeing whether there is any additional BSD, whether coronary is if you suspect any coronary abnormalities or if you suspect any MAPCA. So when you are doing tetralogy of fellow, patient may go to life-threatening cyanotic spell. So that will help make your life a hell. So you have to be ready with all the bailout procedures when you start a cardiac catheterization. So cardiac catheterization may not be so easy. You must be very skillful in that, and you must have all the hardware, yes, and everything ready even pacemaker must be ready in yourself. If there is any like complete heart block, you must be ready for putting a pacemaker immediately, temporary pacing lead. So everything should be ready in your cath lab. We usually do the cardiac catheterization under sedation. So everybody has their own sedation protocol. We have our own protocol. But anytime patient may go to respiratory arrest, you know that all these drugs like midazolam, like fentanyl, like diazepam, like ketamine, these are respiratory inhibitors. So at any time, patient may develop apnea. So whenever you see any dropping of saturation like desaturation in your patient, first of all, look at the breathing of the child. You will see that the patient is apneic. You will innovate that your child is not taking any breath. So in children, respiratory arrest is more common than that of the cardiac arrest. So whenever you will notice any desaturation, please check whether the child is breathing or not. That is the first duty. And the one, the staff circulating nurse or the one who is responsible for the anesthesia or sedation should look at the child constantly. And the operator should keep one of his eye on the monitor, looking the heart rate, looking the saturation. His foot is always ready for pressing the pedal. And his eye is always ready to look the screen. And his hand is always ready to manipulate the catheter. So this is the very difficult coordination between the eye, hand, and foot. So, and also ear. And you have to listen the heartbeat. You keep on the heartbeat so that you will always listen the heartbeat. If you don't listen or you, if you hear that the beat is slow, then you will be able to understand the patient is going to bradycardia. So you must always keep an eye on the screen of the monitor, on your foot for pedaling, on your eyes, on your ear, on your hand. And what is most important for the cardiac catheterization is collection of the sample and collection of the pressure. So what my consultant, when I was in Saudi Arabia, he taught me a few basic things. He said, once you feel any obstruction, please don't proceed. So first safety guard is, when you feel any obstruction, don't push. If you push, then you will be in a complication. So just check whether there is any obstruction, whether the catheter is in the wrong track, whether his catheter is perforating something. So whenever you face and do everything under fluoroscopy guide, don't push your catheter without fluoroscopy guide. Whatever expert you are, I did maybe like 10,000 catheterization, but I don't feel that I am so much expert to manipulate the catheter without fluoroscopy guide. I will be able to do that, but I will never do that. So this is one of the precautions. So don't push and always do it under fluoroscopy. Don't do anything. Don't pass your catheter even through the femoral sheath without fluoroscopy guide. And always take wire guide for the end hole catheter, because end hole catheter may enter into any side branch or enter into anything, may cause any complication, especially in the children. So always take wire guide when you cross a long way for the end hole catheter. And it is very nice to use balloon catheter, like Barben balloon catheter. These are very expensive catheter. For my case, I don't care about money. I care about the safety of my patient. So for diagnostic catheterization, I always use Barben balloon angiography catheter, especially for the young child, so that there will be no chance of puncture or perforation of the heart. And then whenever you enter into a chamber, please record the pressure and saturation. Please take the saturation immediately, because maybe you will not be able to go to that chamber again after hundreds of tiles if you once miss it. Because some of the chambers are very difficult to enter. For example, pulmonary artery in detransposition of great arteries. So once you enter into pulmonary artery in detransposition of great arteries, you please take the sample immediately, please record the pressure immediately. There are some other chambers like in tricuspid atresia, it is very difficult to enter into the right ventricle through the BSD and then enter into the aorta or pulmonary artery. So once you enter to those chambers, you have to complete your pressure recording, you have to complete your saturation measurement, everything quickly. And then even if you lost that position, that does not matter, because you have already measured everything. So these are some tips. Again, what Prakash has mentioned repeatedly, that you, when you are calculating QP-QS ratio, or when are you calculating PVR, all the records you should be done in simultaneous setting. Suppose you are recording femoral artery pressure now in one setting, and then you are measuring pulmonary artery in another setting. So cardiac output and oxygen consumption, these things depends on many conditions of the body. For example, now the heart rate of the child is 100 per minute. So now you are taking the saturation, you are calculating QP, and then again you are recording when the heart rate is 150. So definitely there will be a lot of difference. There will be, if the heart rate increased, cardiac output will be reduced and oxygen extraction will be reduced. So you will have a false QP. So whatever you will do during your cardiac catheterization for like diagnostic purpose, for measuring especially the QP, QS and cardiac output and like PVR calculation, you have to do the things in simultaneous setup. So you need for these two pressure line, one is for the pulmonary artery, one is for the femoral artery. So you have to record femoral artery pressure, pulmonary artery pressure in room air simultaneously. You have to take the saturation simultaneously. Then once you want to do the reversibility test, in our setup, we don't have any nitric oxide or iloprost. So we do these things with as much oxygen as possible, though we don't have any facilities other than our high flow oxygen for 100% saturation or the ventilator for 100% saturation. We just give high flow oxygen as 100% oxygen. And if you want to record these saturations and pressures again after 15 minutes of this oxygen therapy, then you have to record those things simultaneously. Not that you are taking now pulmonary artery sample and after 10 minutes you are now taking femoral artery sample. And then after 5 minutes you are taking mixed venous sample. So you have to record everything simultaneously. Your hand, foot, and your eyes and your ear should be coordinated as much as possible. And you must be ready always for any kind of the untoward effect, any kind of respiratory arrest, any kind of cardiac arrest. And these are actually very normal thing in the cath lab, cardiac arrest, respiratory. And you must be an expert in that before start doing catheterization individually. You have to know how to do the CCR, how to intubate the baby. We have anesthetists, they can do that. But as a cardiologist, you must be an intensivist also. Every cardiologist must be an intensivist. So you, now your child is having some problem, you are calling anesthetist. He will take some time to come, because for normal diagnostic catheterization, you don't need any anesthesia cover. We are the person who are doing these things alone. So suddenly something may happen. You have to be ready. And even if you do not know how to intubate, you just do ambu bagging. By doing ambu bagging, you can save a life for a whole day, unless and until your help is available. So these are some of the things which are important for the hemodynamic study purpose. But for the anatomical study purpose, there are some difficult cases we have, as I have mentioned, like CCTGA, like normal TGA. It is very important to enter into the chamber. And most of the time, our main structure for which we are very concerned is the pulmonary artery. So measuring pulmonary artery pressure, measuring, taking pulmonary artery sample, measuring pulmonary wedge pressure, these are challenging jobs in some, with some of the anatomies. So we should train ourselves how to reach this. Again, crossing BSD is sometimes very difficult. So these are the manipulations we have to learn from our consultant, our senior. Those who are students, you have to learn those carefully from your teachers. And then inshallah, hopefully you will be able to do all those things successfully and without any risk. And with this, I just want to thank Dr. Prakash again for his outstanding presentation, and all the students and the audience again for attending this academic session. Thank you. Mufajjal, you can conclude the session now.
Okay, madam. So thank you, Dr. Prakash Raj. Thank you for your deliberate, nice, and elaborate lecture today. We all the audience and those who will see these lectures and very keenly, they will be benefited and as a reference from your lecture. Madam, who will be the next sessions lecture?
Next one possibly Dr. Shamsuddin from Heart Foundation. I will check and I will let you know later, but definitely there will be a lecture next Friday again. Oh, Dr. Jamil Al-Atta. Next lecture is Dr. Jamil Al-Atta from Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. He will discuss about the congenital adult with congenital heart disease, ACHD.
Okay. So thank you again, Dr. Prakash. Thank you very much for your nice lecture and hope for your nice health in this corona situation. Thank you everybody who are attending these lectures. Thank you all.
Thank you.